enemy forces believe that contained within this building is the heart and inspiration of our movement. They're right. We're winning, boys. Courage. But in our moment of victory, let us not forget the brave women who supported us. Never was there a grander cause for men and women. And never was that cause more grandly served.
I'll just type this up for you, Mr. Connolly.
During Easter week in the GPO, it was James Connolly who commanded the rebel forces. Connolly was a man who knew what it was like to be in a fight. He had spent his whole life fighting. Fighting against poverty, against injustice, and against oppression. He was a soldier and a writer. He was a socialist and a father. And in the end, he was a revolutionary who died for freedom.
Oh, a good novel. Rest. An insurrection. As certainly as Revolution Deluxe.
As long as I live, I will have no rest, only working, educating, organizing and fighting to destroy the forces that produce poverty. These are the words of James Connolly, a man who was no stranger to poverty himself. Connolly was born in an Irish slum in Edinburgh in the year 1868. His parents had emigrated to Scotland from Monaghan and settled in Cowgate, an Irish ghetto where thousands of poor Irish families flocked in the hope of finding work.
He was actually born within St. Patrick's Parish, which was known as Little Ireland. It was very much an Irish ghetto within Edinburgh. His family came from the lowest ranks of rural Ireland. Both his grandparents were rural labourers. He had an education up to the age of about 10 in the local Catholic primary school. He then left and worked mostly in labouring type jobs. Ultimately, because of the economic difficulties he was having, like his brother before him, his elder brother John, he joined the British Army.
Zerrin goretonacher egishin era agne mar lierosche gebeu ken sort egore vi er show agus gore aran de bratna on leshen egor shin a chosins agus a chwevno agus a fa heal er fad na yishin vi gran ege er aran de bratna agus marshin nur a chulishe gore a reshimins lanashtu gazi an inns freigshe and harem.
Connolly had another reason for not wanting to go to India with his regiment. A young lady by the name of Lily Reynolds. Lily moved to Scotland with James after he left the army, and they married in April 1890. They settled in Edinburgh, where Connolly began to get involved in the socialist movement. But with a young family to support, he needed some way to provide for them.
Socialists support one another. Connolly repairs the worn-out understandings of the brethren at standard rates. Ladies' boots, 1 shilling and sixpence. Gents, 2 and 6.
He did establish a cobbler's shop for a while in 1895, but that failed after a few months. He was an absolutely hopeless cobbler. He simply couldn't mend shoes well. Also, he was so engrossed with the socialist movement at that time, he really prioritised that over his own work and his own livelihood, to the detriment, probably, of his family life.
2 months after the birth of his third daughter, word came to Connolly that the Dublin Socialist Club was looking for a full-time secretary, a job that offered a salary of £1 a week. Connolly and his family moved to Dublin, and he set about winning converts to the socialist cause.
But in any march towards nationhood, fundamental questions have to be asked. And the first question that must be answered is, who are the Irish people? Is it the dividend-hunting capitalist with the phraseology of patriotism on his lips and the spoils wrung from sweated Irish toilers in his pockets? Is it the scheming lawyer or the slum landlord or any of these sections which today dominate Irish politics? Or is it rather the Irish working class? The Irish working class must emancipate itself, and in emancipating itself, must free its country.
During the summer of 1896, Connolly founded the Irish Socialist Republican Party, but the organisation struggled with very few members and very little support. As one newspaper reported, the Irish Socialist Republican Party has more syllables than it has members. It was a rare occasion that the party could afford to pay Connolly, and he struggled to support his family. Finally, he decided he would emigrate to America, and in the autumn of 1903, he sailed to New York in the hope of building a better life for his wife and children.
Bhí chláin le tíocht amach go Meiriceá na dhia, agus bhí dáta socraí go Scóise, go dtí Ellis Island le níiad a bhailiú, ach níor tháinig siad ón mád, agus bhí an imní ar arnó, Scóise ríist an lá dár géin, agus ríist níor tháinig siad ón mád, agus fear seachtain a bhí an scéal céanáin. Ar dzeire, chánig sé a chláin a tíocht ach níra an inín behinna leis móna, níra sise láthar, agus sinna nóra a fór sé meach, go raibh timpist éis tárlú. An lá a raibh a chláin le blá clí ágáil, haring móna pota ag an tinne, agus dó a bhí go donna sa timpist sin, bhair sí fe a cúpla dách an sin bhása sí.
My chief motive in coming here was to provide a better field for my girls than was open for them at home. But the girl for whose immediate benefit the change was made was stricken down, and the blow darkened my life and changed all our hopes and prospects.
James Connolly spent the next 7 years in America working with socialist organizations. But it was the time he spent working in the trade union movement and with the industrial workers of the world that had the greatest impact on his political outlook.
The Car Comanua Corher Arbon and Industrial Workers of the World Valig Gana Ibrahe Le Cale and E Craft Union de Viana Car Comandus na Gana Ibrahe Agus Glach Connolly Part Morse and IWW Gmovor in Newark Agus Newark, New Jersey Agus Gmovor Vishig Agru Ibrahe Dugany Eschach Ibrahe As Air Nak Ibrahe As and Adile Freshen Agus con laort lob, con laort leis na himmerkig sin, daulam sé a dailis, agus laort sé golifa as a dailis leis na hibre a sin.
Keep someone's got to speak to him.
Where the hell is Comrade DeLuca? They'll rip this place apart if he don't get here soon.
I'll never let it be said. I didn't give him all for the cause.
Ed ora, camerati, Giuseppe, Connolly!
Camerati, ogni fabbrica organizzata sotto l'egida della Industrial Workers of the World è una fortezza strappato della controlla della classe capitalista. Dobbiamo unire contro il capitalismo. Avanti alla Repubblica Socialista! Bravo!
Although Connolly was organizing workers of all nationalities, Ireland was never far from his thoughts. In 1907, he helped organize the Irish Socialist Federation in New York to help support Irish workers.
It would be difficult to understate the importance of the Irish Socialist Federation in terms of Connolly's re-engagement with Ireland. It brought him into regular contact with socialists back in Dublin. And with the emergence in 1909 of a reinvigorated Socialist Party of Ireland, Connolly realised that there could now be opportunities to return to Ireland and become perhaps a full-time organiser for either the Labour movement or the Socialist movement.
I have set my heart on getting back to Ireland. I feel that most anyone can do the work I'm doing here, but that there is work to be done in Ireland, that I can do better than most anyone. I'm always dreaming of Ireland, dreaming of going back to the fight at home. Now, you know I have a way of trying to realize my dreams. I think I'll try and realize this one.
On the evening of the 14th of July 1910, a farewell dinner was held in Kavanagh's restaurant in New York for James Connolly. Connolly was returning to Ireland and to the fight for Irish freedom.
Connolly arrived back to Ireland in 1910 and he returned to a very changed situation. The emergence of the Irish Transport and General Workers Union at that time was a massively significant event. The ITGWU meant that unskilled workers were being mobilised and unionised for the first time in large numbers in Dublin. Probably the most important figure at the head of that movement was Jim Larkin.
Jim Larkin was born to Irish parents in Liverpool in 1876. And like Connolly, he had been sent out to work when he was still a child. Like Connolly, Larkin had spent his life campaigning on behalf of the labouring classes. And on Connolly's return to Ireland, they joined forces on behalf of Dublin's workers, who were in a more desperate plight than ever.
Connolly was somebody who had direct experience of poverty. He was born into dire poverty in Scotland, into tenement life. He would have been very aware then, when he came back to Ireland and settled in Ireland, of the extent to which things simply had not changed. If you look at Dublin in the years in the run-up to the Rising, you can see the extent of poverty. There were 26,000 people who were living in tenements. 20,000 of those 26,000 were living in one-roomed tenements. If you go to individual streets under the 1911 census, you can see the degree of overcrowding that existed. To take Henrietta Street, for example, on the north side of the city, what had once been a relatively salubrious area, there are 15 houses in Henrietta Street with 835 people living in those 15 houses. James Connolly would have been very aware of that, and James Connolly was somebody who would have said that Ireland, or the concept of Ireland, doesn't mean anything to me if it doesn't recognise the individuals that make up Ireland and what they are enduring. And the lack of rights that workers had as well, as became so patently obvious during the 1913 lockout.
The ITGWU was seen as a serious development by many employers in Dublin. William Martin Murphy in particular was appalled by the emergence of this union, and he considered Larkin to be a dangerous firebrand. Martin Murphy was adamant that the ITGWU had to be faced down, and in August 1913 he laid off 100 of his employees who he believed to be members of the union. He also asked his remaining employees to sign a pledge to say that they wouldn't join the ITGWU. Consequently, strike action was initiated, and the consequence of it was the Dublin lockout of 1913, a lockout that involved 20,000 workers within the city, probably 80,000 people in total if you include their dependents. It was a massive industrial dispute that led to much street violence and led also to the jailing of both Larkin and Connolly for a brief period as a result of speeches they made in favour of the locked out workers.
Baton charges, prison cells, untimely death and acute starvation. All were faced without a murmur, and in the face of them all, the brave Dublin workers never lost faith in their ultimate triumph. Never doubted but that their organisation would emerge victorious from the struggle. Ah, comrades, it is good to have lived in Dublin in these days.
Connolly was arrested on the 30th of August and sentenced to 3 months in prison. He went on hunger strike and starved himself for a week until the authorities relented and he was released. As Larkin was still in jail, Connolly was the man in charge at Liberty Hall, and he set about organising a workers' defence force.
A real socialist movement can only be born of struggle, of uncompromising affirmation of the faith within us. The Dublin fight is more than a trade union fight. It is a great class struggle, and recognised as such by all sides. Now listen to me. I'm going to talk sedition. The next time we're out on a march, I want to be accompanied by four battalions of trained men. I say nothing about arms at present. But when we want them, we know where we can find them.
The Irish Citizen Army was one of the flints that would spark off the 1916 Rising, but the strikers were not the only ones arming themselves. In the north, the Ulster Volunteer Force was formed by Unionists to oppose Home Rule, and in the winter of 1913, Nationalists set about organising their own military force, the Irish Volunteers. The Dublin lockout lasted over 6 months, but in early 1914, workers who were starving and desperate began to drift back to work, and the strike was broken.
Dublin is isolated, and so we Irish workers must again go down into hell. Bow our backs to the lash of the slave driver, let our hearts be seared by the iron of his hatred, and instead of the sacrificial wafer of brotherhood and common sacrifice, eat the dust of defeat and betrayal.
No reference to Ireland over the Harlanida Cahardig, B3 William Trumhosh of Bolta Ergonilach, Ivrahain Hepperstalkim Latlia, Ivrado. Fogar Realtas na Bratana, gynnean fi creuchiaid ser yn tir. Seachas Parliament Nefsbloch a bheith ag Eirin Maravi Gialta, fór se mac gwrw hen tir le gara na gha lia, agus gwmach stát eantachtach bunny o hua, agus bóas agon rwyd eisiau dar leis, agus jyn ifrit tri, hannig yn cog y môr, agus hitz yn ychlwysiad hosilach as y chéle.
Thank you.
One of the things that brought James Connolly on board, I think, was the outbreak of the First World War. And James Connolly's notion that this was British imperialism at its worst during this First World War, particularly in terms of the people who were going to pay the ultimate price, or pay a disproportionate price, as he would have seen it, those working class people who were enlisting and who were enrolling in this army and who were going to become effectively pawns and were going to be slaughtered on that basis. And what he effectively does is to declare a war on war.
Should the working class of Europe rather than slaughter each other for the benefit of kings and financiers proceed tomorrow to erect barricades all over Europe, we should be perfectly justified in following such a glorious example and contribute to the dismemberment of the vulture class. The crown and rule the world.
War is upon us, and we are helpless. What then becomes of our resolutions, all our threats of general strikes, all our carefully built internationalism, all our hopes for the future? Were they all as sound and fury, signifying nothing? Would it not be better for all capable of bearing arms to resolve to fight, and if need be, to die, for freedom here at home?
Connolly's position in the past would have been one that favoured mass insurrection with the working class at the forefront of the revolution. With the outbreak of the war and the collapse of the socialist movement across Europe, Connolly started to look towards a small-scale insurrection. As a consequence, Connolly became involved in building up the Irish Citizen Army into a fighting force with the intention of involving it in an insurrection against British rule in Ireland.
But Connolly wasn't the only one planning an insurrection. The IRB, a secret society pledged to overthrow British rule in Ireland, had formed a military council at the outbreak of the war to investigate the possibility of staging a nationwide rebellion. The military council consisted of Éamon Cant, Joseph Plunkett and Patrick Pearse, but it was being directed by Sean McDiarmid and Tom Clark, who had been stealthily moving nationalists towards insurrection for years. Connolly and his citizen army were now threatening to preempt their plans.
He's pushed us so far, we need to think that we need to make him believe so. Right, if you send out a message.
The great danger was, of course, that Connolly might act and drag in the rank and file of the volunteers. And indeed, that actually was Connolly's plan. What, set the ball rolling and let everyone else come in. That would upset the meticulous planning and timing that Clark and McDiarmid were engaged in. And Connolly is apparently, at the end of 1915 and early 1916, determined to act.
The war in Europe has brought about a crisis which may contain, as yet hidden within it, the moment that generations have been waiting for. Remember, England's difficulty is Ireland's opportunity!
Connolly agira rudi kinte yenna ach bakas go hen nach rens ramela in arira gleogen a public tori sha vi should a kinds ach nyrishte gira yenna agus viksha ra gemine gehoskelte gemach an tarm kahra sasta trods as the pain few marmach in the nella sasta lesh kendach ach bezer gahed ball like an arm.
Mr. Connolly.
Mr. Pearse. England's difficulty is Ireland's opportunity. Isn't it about time you got yourselves a new slogan?
I'll bear that in mind when I'm writing my next speech. James, there's a commemoration in Bowdenstown in a month's time for Wolf Tone. Will you be in attendance?
When are you fellas going to stop blathering on about dead fiends and talk about live ones instead?
By the winter of 1915, James Connolly's mind was set on revolution. He was determined to lead the Citizen Army out and to strike a blow against the British Empire, a move which would have preempted the IRB's plans and destroyed any hope they had of staging their own rising. The IRB decided that Connolly would have to be taken care of.
They had to deal with Connolly. They either actually had to terminate him politically or bring him on side.
On the 19th of January 1916, Connolly was stopped by two IRB men who had been ordered to bring him to meet the IRB Military Council. Connolly accompanied them to a brickworks in Dolphin's Barn, where Sean McDiarmida, Joseph Plunkett, and Patrick Pearce were waiting for him.
Was the escort really necessary?
Have a seat.
James, there's been an awful lot of talk about you going out on your own with the Citizen Army.
Maybe there has. At least there's been some talk about something. There's been no talk about what you're doing.
It's the way we like it. The date has been set. A rebellion will take place.
We have 5,000 men in Dublin and 5,000 in the provinces that are ready to rise at any moment. The German government are committed to a shipment of arms and ammunition and potentially an expeditionary force in the event that our enterprise is successful.
And why would I, or the Citizen Army, have any interest in your cause?
We share similar aims, James.
Do we?
It's as simple as this. When we get closer to our goal, you will also get closer to yours.
If you're going to ask me to join with this and you're going to tell me that I'll be closer to my goals, what kind of guarantees can I expect?
Vi gulliora ko pesh taku lesh na hybrid ni de trade take mar humble vision bio la kosher lucht hybrid machina rola seg ach snam ken a vis seg nach social event up nach rushe gira revlo to shilach mar vishashne gira kharbon la plenta.
I have every interest in this country being free, but I have far more interest in the citizens of this country owning and running this country.
They can own and run this country when it's free.
Dorch O'Conneila, a pin in the hand of a child can pierce the heart of a giant. Darlesh, ga nairoglesh na hirinig, airi maki enev a gwine nasasnuk. De chwirok shin tus la makali fuid on down. Imas na kosfuinter isasna, ak imas nanini, kolinehe, san afrik, agus san oish. Ni a wan garoder occur son adir fein. Ach, Garouder a cur son Bochtan and Dowin, the wretched of the earth, Mardierfi. So, is Stonkhaber and Yowl Kushnet and Tais Shin, a Glach O'Conneila part in Sinairi Amach?
From January 1916 onwards, Connolly is on board. Citizen Army and the Irish Volunteers are together, and to formalise that arrangement, Connolly is appointed onto the military council.
By the time James Connolly joined the military council, a date for the rising had been set. Easter Sunday, the 23rd of April, 1916. Liberty Hall now became a centre of revolutionary activity and was guarded around the clock by members of the Citizen Army. But although Connolly had committed his forces to the Republican cause, he had not abandoned his socialist principles.
However it may be for others, for us in the Citizen Army, there is but one ideal. An Ireland owned and ruled by Irish men and Irish women. The Citizen Army will only cooperate in a forward movement. And the moment that that movement ceases to be, we reserve the right to step out of alignment. The odds against us may be 1,000 to 1. But if we should win, hold on to your rifles. The volunteers may have a different goal. But remember, our goal is not just political liberty, but economic liberty as well. So, hold on to your rifles.
It was in Liberty Hall on Easter Sunday that the Proclamation of the Irish Republic was printed. It was produced in the worn-out printing press James Connolly used to publish the Workers' Republic by three members of the Citizen Army: Michael Molloy, William O'Brien, and Christopher Brady.
So when I was done printing the proclamations, Commandant Connolly came in and said, "Are you finished, Chris?" "Yes, sir, Commandant." "Well," says he, "tie them up in two parcels, 1250 in each parcel." Well, then when they were cleared away and the machine was cleared, the printing, Countess Margaret was admitted in. She came in a violent temper. She threw a telegram on the board of the machine. She, Commandant, she read that. So whatever was in it, I could not say, but she was in a raging temper. One thing I did hear was, says Commandant James, says she, "I'll shoot Mike Neal."
"What has he done? What has that son of a bitch McNeil done?"
"See for yourself."
"Owing to the very critical situation, all orders given to the Irish volunteers for tomorrow, Easter Sunday, are hereby rescinded, and no parades, marches, or other movements of Irish volunteers will take place. Each individual volunteer will obey this order strictly in every particular."
"The same countermand has been sent out to every volunteer circle in the country. We'll be lucky to have 100 men turn up."
"We've been planning to remach Ebra Owen McNeil and Faravé Gannis Gahifigul Erna Hogley. Near a shish and partsuch in Ulbo and Iremach, ach fi so lakab, Gunglakashe lish, nor a Hunnakshe Gresha Gultarlo. Ach fi yerin shacht and the vise soler, Gugurisha and Iren and Iremach, agus Hushe Ordomach, and Zalchishes and Nochdon, a rawlish and Hogley, Gore Hullahort, Kura Erkal. Honig and Kostamila Tadihela, agus. We play the Zenak, Erkarko Bagalorai, Erkarko and Rotahura Kal, Noe Rahlo. Wall a Hudis Moakab, Gamakarko, Lianatarai, Akla, Nis Fudza, Agus Martian, Okrashid, Gamakan Tayri Mahan, Kegare Wadni Slodina, Akablain Irimach, Akamaksha, Eternal Law Nis Sterni, Luan Koska, Shakastona Koska. Orsi na poblachta imla tlia. Ruta da gresha moran gyanis her nair imach ar fad mar is belga harla tevmwag an frivcha her. Vi Tishkin take it at horsey milita, Vishanon, Ordo Hurstahuina, Vishahain, Hulamafagus, a rich wind quitkin vasabig dina aid, shot in a visasta, Huligon Torse Hain, Martian, Pichart Massabet, Erin Turmi Viegia, Agus Lakalisha, Lisha Thrower, Hugsha, Dorts and Piercecarno, Gobeshin, Incin Thrower, and Iriamach.
It seems that Connolly initially thought that it would be possible to stage a successful rising, one that would have a lasting impact and would spread across the country. However, in the days before the Easter Rebellion, he began to understand that the plan had gone slightly astray, that the guns weren't arriving and the mobilisation wasn't going to happen to the extent that it was meant to. And it seems that when he marched out on Easter Monday, he was aware that the rising was doomed to failure. He certainly said as much, it seems, to William O'Brien. But he probably maintained the belief that it would kick off something larger.
Dort on Canílach leis an Biarsach, for us to strike is to win. Balor on Gníomh a Dhéanamh, le go ndéanfaí Aithris air, san Ind, san Afric agus mar sin de. Nor gá ach an tíobhá sin a chur fáil. Ach is dócha beidir gur chiapadar go mbeadh tacaíocht le fáil agus go mbeadh sin an poblacht a ógurt agus a chuináil beo níos faide ná seachtain bháin.
I would expect the British to launch assaults here and here. So if we place barricades here and here in Abbey Street...
Lancers! Lancers are coming, sir!
Fire, hold your fire! Do not fire until I give the command! You hear me? Let them gallop the full end of the building! Wait for my order to shoot!
Now's our chance! They won't know what hit them!
Cease fire! Cease fire!
They're retreating, sir!
They're retreating!
Connolly as commandant on the Tuesday does something very significant. He begins to reinforce various locations in O'Connell Street that had not been occupied.
I've posted men at the Imperial Hotel. They're going to defend it there to the left. What's this?
The hopes of Monday that a nationwide revolt might have happened, they are gone. When he reinforces these locations around the General Post Office, I think by the Tuesday he's accepting a British counterattack is coming and they're going to be blasted out of the GPO.
There's reports that they may have taken the top end of Sackville Street. As far as we know, there's possibly a gun on the roof of the rotunda.
Well, we must maintain positions here until reinforcements arrive.
But we have to formulate a plan based on the fact that we may be here for quite a lot longer than we thought. We can withstand a frontal assault, but we have to formulate a new strategy.
Shells.
Men, get your posts. Hold your posts steady.
Is Castle Gore Gorhoshe Ianta said nor hasa Aram na Bratton a Kaha Sluganlio, Bisha Nurisha Solishin, a Bezagresha Sol, Gazokazi Shach, I guess Gomedish Parsoch, a Drodi Lava, a Shachashin Hokrashid, Bome Kaha, I guess, and Kaha Hor Trihine, Harida.
Men, take your possessions! Hold fast!
Nur Hanigan Dierdin, Huishe Feinamach, Vashif Winamson Gorhor, Furganti Ella, Ahoil and Akaloiva, Huishe Feinamach, on Ifigan Irish Independent Ahoil, Rawa Anhamul, Tushkan Shannonidas, Sidere Fein, Agus Uinair and Independent, William Martin Murphy. Ach is san achtrushin a gortiog godana e vuil ricoche a ruitin agus yinti andamash to dogus vise gomur e bain asahamach.
Oh, God,
I've got to walk out. And Gorto, for sure, and I'd imagine she hadn't done brisha a routine or fad, agus vi pian uasach a fulling tegia. Vi doctor oan in ar defig a fost a rinia a yihil, leis a meid a vi egia, leis a bian sin a weilo a fos. Vi pian uasach ganiloch.
Is to go to the Falcons. If we get as far as Bow Street, then we'll be fine.
Right, we start evacuations in an hour. We're staying for one more hour. One final stand.
Despite his injury, Connolly refused to leave with the wounded. And when the rebels were forced to evacuate the building on Friday, he was amongst the last to leave, borne on a stretcher and shielded from the bullets by members of the citizen army. When the decision came to surrender on the following day, the order was countersigned by Connolly.
Connolly was actually eventually brought to Dublin Castle for treatment of his injuries. There he was also court-martialed and sentenced to death to be executed on the 12th of May. His wife and his daughter, Lily and Nora, actually visited James in Dublin Castle before his execution.
Tonight, I slept for the first time in weeks. And I was woken at 11 and told that I'd be shot at dawn. Please, Lily, don't cry. You'll unman me.
Oh, James, your beautiful life.
But hasn't it been a full life, Lily? And isn't this a good end? Don't cry, Lily. Don't cry, no.
Dad talked about little things. He was trying to plan her life for him after he was gone, and then they told us time was up and we'd have to go. He was to be shot at dawn, you see. So, Mum, we couldn't get Mum away from the bed. The nurse had to come finally and help her away. And I went to the door, and then I went back to him. That was the last I saw him.
Shame, Mogila.
Without its people is nothing to me. And the man who is bubbling over with love and enthusiasm for Ireland and can pass unmoved through our streets and witness all the wrong and suffering, the shame and degradation wrought upon the people of Ireland, aye, wrought by Irish men upon Irish men and women, and without burning to end it, is, in my opinion, a fraud and a liar in his heart.
Beam shop on airport got low. A quick a croix sector in your. Or squeal a wham on vocal bio. Snow rift her tourish white bog brown. Shameless Mogilamar Shame Hazer Gilamar Soon a shame Nivuras Hazer.